And one more question. Sorry, well, how will we be able to see the questions?
I'll ask you them at the end.
Okay, cool. Awesome.
All right. Hello, everybody, and welcome to another session of Dental Shadowing. Today, we have Tyler Brown, who is a D4 at Tufts, and he's going to talk to us about his dental journey as well as some tips for success in dental school. So, Tyler, you can go ahead and take it away.
Awesome. Well, thank you for having me today, but we will go ahead and get started. So about me, my name is Tyler Brown. I am a fourth year dental student at Tufts. Some of my hobbies are, of course, dental school, because that takes up a lot of my time, but content creation, business, and eventually film. And so I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. I say Atlanta just because nobody really knows the town that I'm from. It's called Alpharetta. It's about 40 minutes north of Atlanta. Educational background, I went to Howard University as an HBCU in Washington, D.C. And then I got my master's in biomedical sciences from Baylor University in Miami, Florida. As far as like undergrad and beyond, I did my 1 year gap year, and then I did a 1 year master's program. So yeah. So why did I pursue dentistry? So I didn't have any doctors, any dentists in my family at all. And it's funny, I used to work at IHOP. And so I was a server at IHOP from like 14 until 18. And that's kind of when I got comfortable with speaking to a lot of people at once, if that makes any sense. And I remember one of my regulars, they told me that they thought I would be a good dentist. I don't know why, but they just kind of brought it up one day, and it kind of stuck with me. And so when I went to Howard, I started looking for all these different things to do just to kind of get a feel for the actual profession. And so there was this program called SMDEP. Now it's called SPEP, I believe. Well, basically all these different dental schools and medical schools would invite students out for the summer, and you would spend like 6 or 8 weeks there and kind of get exposed to medical school and dental school. And so I did mine at UCLA's dental school / medical school. It had a great time. Obviously, LA is amazing, but the program was well ran, and it really, really did expose me to dentistry and, you know, medicine. And at that point, that's when I decided, you know what, I want to pursue dentistry. So after that summer, the next summer, you know, coming off of the last summer, I was super excited, and I decided, you know, I want to look for another program that can hopefully help me prepare for my DAT. And I found a program at Texas A&M's College of Dentistry. Back then it was called Baylor College of Dentistry, but it was still located in the middle of Dallas. And it was very, very intense. That was probably the most stressful summer I had ever had. Basically keeping up with all these DAT prep classes, as well as taking some dental school classes. Not really, but we were just sitting in, and there was just a lot of information at once. But that's kind of where I learned about the vigor of dental school, and just kind of braced me for what I would have to deal with once I actually got in. And I believe both these programs, I know SPEP is still going on. I mean, yeah, SPEP, the UCLA one with all the different schools, I know that's still going on. SPEP 2 for the Texas A&M School of Dentistry, that still might be going on. But if you all are interested, please do your research. And I always tell all pre-dents, make sure that you go to these summer programs, because you get a lot of opportunity to meet with admissions directors and dental students. This is kind of a time before social media, because it's kind of easy now just to reach out to any of us, but it's still a great opportunity. So boom, my career pathway. Of course, step one was undergrad. Then I went to go get my master's. I'm in dental school now, excited to graduate in about 2 months. After that, I put apprentice, but really that means just me working under somebody for about 2 years. But then as soon as possible, as soon as I feel comfortable, I'm definitely looking to buy my own practice and be able to run my own shop. So that's what everything looks like for me. So why dentistry? I remember the first day at Tufts, they were like, being a dentist, you're able to be a doctor, an engineer, and an artist. And of course, I really didn't understand that, it being so new. But now that I'm actually sitting there with my patients, sitting there, hearing all of their health conditions, all their health history, doing all these different things, then on top of all of that, working with my hands to craft the perfect prep, then the perfect temporary and things of this nature, it's really like you are you are building a skill with your hands, your verbal approach, as well as your business sense. And that's why I really do love dentistry. I never really thought I wanted to specialize. I know a lot of people in my class do, and that's one of the main perks of Tufts. Little, you know, side note, at Tufts, we have all the specialties. So if you are somebody who is interested in going to endo, oral surgery, whatever it may be, literally they're all upstairs. So some of my classmates, for instance, say somebody who's interested in orthodontics, they would go upstairs. This is the first year they would go upstairs and just shadow in the ortho clinic. Because I knew that I was very, very interested in the business side of dentistry. And I kind of get, I don't want to say this to sound, you know, weird or anything, but I get kind of bored very easily. So I like the aspect of general dentistry, whereas I could do a little bit of everything as well as run my own business. So that's why I decided to go and be a general dentist, you know, outside of everything else. Also, for a second, I did think about doing oral surgery. I thought that it would just kind of be cool to say I was an oral surgeon. But as a dentist, as a general dentist, you're also doing surgery. Of course, not as extensive as an oral surgeon, but of course, you're still doing surgery when you're doing these extractions and things of that nature, as well as flaps. But with oral surgery, I think I remember I got like my first like B minus, and that kind of discouraged me from becoming an oral surgeon. So everybody, if you do get a B minus in any of these classes, if you get a B, even if you get a C, do not be discouraged like I was. It is still very possible for you to become your dream of being an oral surgeon. You might just need to make a lot of A's after you get that C or that B minus. So anyway, boom. The typical day of a dental student. I just want to let everybody know, me and my roommate, he actually just came in just a second ago. He came in from clinic. We actually have a vlog / Instagram called Future DDS. And you know, this presentation, this is exactly why we created our platform. We literally documented every single week of our dental school experience starting from week one. And here's like a little funny tip. If you go look at our first video, you might even see like a little line on the screen. And that's because we were using like a cracked iPhone just to start making these videos. And so you really are able to see the progression of us. And it's pretty interesting. So if you ever do want to go see what it's like to be a dental student, of course, go check out our vlogs. That's why we made them. And of course, you can always ask us questions on our Instagram at _futureDDS. But so typical day as a dental student, first year, second year, third year, fourth year are all very, very different. And I believe I get into this a little bit later, so I'm going to kind of hold off on that. But literally, you run into different challenges each year, and you are forced to grow each year. So we'll get into that a little bit later. Before dental school, while I was at Howard in undergrad, I was in the pre-dental club. I wasn't like the president or anything like that. I did go to like all the different events that they had, and I really did a good job at networking. And when it came time for me to apply to dental school, I was able to lean on the people that I had met while I was networking. And I got a lot of opportunities that I feel like I wouldn't have if I hadn't known the people, if that makes sense. So if you're in the pre-dental club, be active. If you can be president, vice president, do that. That's another great way to get involved. But just make sure that whenever you all go to these different events, you all are shaking as many hands as possible. And I always tell people, and I tell this to myself every time I go into a new room, I am the mayor. What does that mean? Of course, a mayor shakes hands and talks to everybody. That's what you need to do. And if you feel uncomfortable doing that, it's a skill you're going to have to be a dentist. So go ahead and work at it. And it is a skill. I don't want you to think that, you know, it's something, it's natural for everybody. No, there are so many studies and different ways for you to get better at conversing with people. So just do your work. You know, do the work, get your practice, and you'll be fine. So another extracurricular thing I did was research, but I actually did nothing with regards to dental research. I actually was like catching salamanders outside in the neighboring areas of DC, like in Virginia and stuff. So that was just something that I wanted to do. Growing up in the South, you know, I love fishing and being in the woods. And so we had a research professor who offered this this animal research, and I just decided to do that. But it did come up in my interview, so I guess it did work out for me. DAT prep. There are so many new resources for a DAT. You know, I think that the golden standard right now is DAT Bootcamp. I use DAT Boot Camp. I also use Destroyer, and I also use this thing called AP Cliss Bio 3. I don't know about the last year. I don't know about Destroyer or Cliffs AP Bio 3 anymore, but DAT Bootcamp has been pretty consistent, and I've been helping out a bunch of pre-dents, and I've seen that DAT Bootcamp has worked for a lot of them. So definitely go check that out. As far as DAT, my advice to everybody, and I want you to take this with a grain of salt, because I do understand that everybody is not in this position, but if you are able to, for the 2 months, 2.5 months, 3 months, whatever it is that you're studying, you need to solely be focused on the DAT. You know, I think that that was one of my biggest mistakes with regards to taking it. Granted, I only took it once, but I know I would have made a better score if I had dropped all the extracurricular stuff that I was doing and also working. So I was also working, and that's why I say, you know, I understand everybody can't drop everything, but what I really want people to understand is that the DAT is your second chance to get into dental school. And what I mean by that is, from me talking to a bunch of admissions directors, from me being in dental school and just conversing with my classmates, the DAT is what's going to get you in. Your GPA, let's say if your GPA is a little bit lower, if it's a 3.0, 3.1, 3.2, if you crush that DAT, that's your second opportunity to still get into dental school. And I promise you, I've seen many of people with a 3.2 GPA, 3.1 GPA, who did well on the DAT get into dental school. And I promise you that. So I don't know if you all are on different forums or if you're hearing rumors about, oh, I need to get a 3.6, 3.7. Granted, it's amazing if you do so, but take that DAT seriously. I promise you, you will not regret it. As far as service and shadowing, granted, I know a lot of you all are in a weird predicament right now, because of COVID, and granted, that's why this platform was created, I'm assuming. But I actually did work with Bread for the City, which was a nonprofit free clinic in Washington, D.C. And it's funny, because while I was shadowing, I didn't know what was going on. You know, I'm just there. I'm just watching him fill, do some extractions. And now that I look back on those times, it's just super interesting. Even me, like, reflecting on some of the things the doctor suggested to me, you know, it's crazy that I, like, remember those things and I'm applying those things now. But during the time, I really didn't know what was going on. But, you know, you all shadow as much as you can. I have talked to a lot of admissions directors, and they have told me that they all understand that we're in a pandemic. So if your shadowing hours are not as rambunctious as the previous years, you know, i.e. 150, 200 hours, it's okay. I promise you, it's okay. So don't worry about that too much. Okay, boom. So like I said, I go to Tufts University School of Dental Medicine. I am literally in the middle of Boston. My apartment is in the middle of Boston, and my rent shows that I am in the middle of Boston. I pay a lot of money to be up here, but it's been a great experience so far. So why did I choose dental school, the dental school of my choice? Boom. So major city. I love major cities. I'm from Atlanta. Then I moved to Chicago. Then I moved to Miami. Now I'm here in Boston. And I just love being in that like metro area, you know, especially while I'm young. Of course, when I get a little bit older, I'll move out to the suburbs. But I want options. I want to be able to meet a lot of people, talk to a lot of people. That might not be something that you care about. And granted, realistically, because of COVID, I missed out on a lot of stuff that I would have done anyway. But regardless, clinical experience, that was also something that I really, really cared about. And I was honestly a little bit worried at first when I came to Tufts, because, you know, here I am thinking, okay, our class is about 220, 240 people. How is everybody going to get patients? But what I am going to tell you all is, at least at Tufts, we had a lot of patients to go around. I remember at one point my roster, I had about 50 patients on my roster. And granted, that doesn't sound like a lot, and it's not a lot in the real world, but in dental school, you know, I was busy and I was able to see 3 patients a day whenever I wanted to. The last thing, I actually got a scholarship to go to Tufts, and that really, really swayed my decision to go. And once again, that all comes down to your grades and your GPA and that DAT score. So knock that out, y'all. Definitely knock that out. Three most important factors I looked for, once again, clinic was huge. Me knowing that I wanted to be general dentist, I wanted to make sure that I got as much experience as possible and just see as much as possible. And that's another thing, like I said, them Tufts having the specialties upstairs, you know, granted, I wasn't like the students who wanted to go to ortho who was up in the ortho clinic every single day, but I would go upstairs. I would go to Perry. I would go to ortho every now and then and just kind of check out, you know, what's going on. Oh, how do you all do a sinus lift? Oh, what is crown lengthening? Oh, boom, 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 doing all these different things. And that's why, you know, I was really inspired to come to Tufts because I knew that was available. Resources. So another great thing about Tufts, even though it's super, super expensive, there are a lot of resources. And what do I mean about resources? I was able to go to Peru for 3 weeks my second year, you know, and granted, I paid a little bit of money, but nothing compared to what we spent on travel and everything. And that was through Tufts just being the machine that Tufts is. And we call ourselves at Tufts global leaders of oral health. And so pre-COVID, that was definitely one of the main disciplines within our school. And granted, it's definitely slowed down now, but I'm sure it'll pick back up as soon as everything gets back a little bit back to normal. Also with resources, you know, I think Tufts being such a big school, Boston being such a great city, a lot of people come to Tufts to kind of like promote and promote their stuff, whatever they have going on. So if some doctor has a class on smile design, he'll come in, give this great lecture that some people will pay thousands of dollars to see to us students for free. And granted, I'm sure they do that at a lot of schools, but from what I've heard here at Tufts, it's very, very common. And we get it a lot more than a lot of other dental schools. And I know that because I talk to a lot of people from a lot of dental schools. So keep that in mind. And that's what I kept in mind. Another important factor I looked into, money. Money is huge, y'all. And granted, you know, it's an investment into your future. It definitely is. But if you have the opportunity to go somewhere that, you know, is a little bit cheaper for you and that you feel like you will have the same experience, $200,000 is a lot less than $400,000. And I will say that without my scholarship, I would have been hurting a lot more. But like I said, y'all, just money. The money thing is very serious and very real. And I don't know how many of you all have your parents to kind of help you out, because that's a real blessing. But I was not in that position. So money was a huge factor in my decision. So boom, the worst and best part of dental school. Okay, so the best part was the network I built as well as my personal development. You know, I think that in life, everything is relative, right? You all are studying for the DAT. You all are taking your college classes. You're taking like what, like 21 credits, 22, whatever it may be. And that feels really hard, right? And it is relatively. And I felt the same way. But then I went to my master's program and you know, instead of that 22 credits, now I'm taking 30 credits. And I'm like, whoa, in all science classes, there were no gym. There was no, you know, filler classes like that. So that was hard. So then I got to dental school and now I'm balancing school. I'm living in a new city by myself. I'm balancing relationships. And I'm learning a whole new skill set with my hands. And it's just a lot at one time. But the great thing about dental school is that you will rise to the occasion. And you will learn just how much your body can really, not even your body, your mind can really put up with. And so now, you know, and this sounds, I mean, probably not crazy for some, but like I used to wake up at like 9, 10. Now I wake up at 5 a.m. every morning and I'm just working, 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 working. And I'm doing good work and I'm used to it now. And so it's like dental school has shown me just how much work I can actually do in a day. And that makes your days just so much more purposeful. And it's like, it sounds crazy, but I really feel like I'm living life now because I'm doing so many things. I'm going to the gym. I'm helping patients. I'm on social media. I'm helping pre-dents. I'm doing all these things in one day. And I'm just like, wow, with this type of, with this awakening, with me understanding that I can do all of this, I can just make that much more impact on my patients' lives in the future as well as the community. So that's one thing I really do really do thank dental school for. Also my network. So granted, 220 students, but now these are 220 future doctors, and everybody's from all different areas of the world. And on top of that, we have four classes. So that's what, 880 students in total, as well as all of the faculty, as well as being in Boston and just networking with so many different people. And, you know, there's that cliche saying where it's like your net worth is your equals your network, whatever, you know what I'm saying? And it's so true, y'all. It's so true. I've gotten so many great opportunities just based off me knowing somebody. And so I love that about dental school. I love that, you know, everybody, we're all professionals, but we all know how to have fun, and everybody has a story. Everybody is interesting. Now, of course, you're going to have some people who are very, you know, very chill people who don't like to do a lot, which is also great because you need to know people like that. You need to know people who just know how to relax and chill, and you don't have to do the most around or whatever it may be. So definitely the network in dental school was amazing. The worst things, boom, cost. Like I said before, it's very expensive living here in Boston. Just to give you all kind of a look on how much it costs. So I think tuition at Tufts for like a normal student, no scholarship, is about, and cost of living is like $120,000 a year. So after 4 years, boom, that's $500,000. And, you know, depending on how you want to pay that back, if you pay it back over the extended amount of time, you're looking at $1 million that you paid for school. Was it worth it? For me, of course. Yes, I definitely think it's worth it. Just because I believe I am going to do what I need to do in order to pay that back as soon as possible, one. But also, dentistry is an amazing profession. And, you know, it's the only profession where you can, one, own your own practice, two, work 3 days a week if you want to do that and still make a substantial amount of money. And three, I feel like the patient doctor relationship in dentistry is so unique in the fact that like you're able to really sit down and talk to a patient for like 20 minutes and talk about their life and be a part of the community and do all these different things, as well as another huge thing that I've just recently learned. In dentistry, we are able to immediately take people out of pain. And granted, you all haven't felt that yet because of course you all are still pre-dents, but when you get to dental school, you're going to have somebody come in and you might be doing an emergency rotation. Somebody comes to you with a super swollen face and they say, you know what? I am dying. I cannot sleep. I am crying. And you'll just see tears coming down and you'll see their face is super flush and they just don't know what to do, but they look at you and it is your job to get them out of pain. And the second that you do that, I promise you it is the best feeling you have felt in a while. I don't know the great feelings y'all have. I'm sure y'all do a bunch of stuff, but it is an amazing feeling. And the fact that you're able to have that on a consistent basis and get your patients out of pain, it's amazing. But y'all see what I'm talking about when y'all get to dental school. Another worst thing is the weather. Boston, super cold. You know, I've gone through like 3 space heaters in the last 4 years. There's a lot of snow. I've slipped. It's crazy. It's really cold up here. Another thing, the thing is pressure. There is a lot of pressure in dental school. I think that there's a pressure that the school puts on you, kind of, but also the pressure that you put on yourself. You know, it gets to a point where you start getting into this mode where, you know, you don't only want to just not disappoint yourself, but you don't want to disappoint your family, your friends. You're on Instagram saying, hey, I got into dental school, but yet you're struggling on these quizzes, these tests. It's just a lot of pressure that definitely can be avoided if you are in the right mindset. And what do I mean by that? By getting rest. You know, a lot of people do these all-nighters, but I'm like, yo, we have a test. We have 2 tests every week. So are you pulling all-nighters twice a week? And you literally are able to see, especially during your second year, and I'll go into that a little bit later, you're able to see people's health start to decline because they're not sleeping. You know, people aren't taking the time out to meditate, not taking the time out to exercise. And I'm able to talk about all this because I was one of those people. I was pulling the all-nighters, you know, and I'm falling asleep all day, then just being up all night, and then I'm going to class and falling asleep. My back is starting to hurt because I'm always arched over. I'm not working out. You know, my mind, I'm always feeling stressed, but it's because I'm not taking the right time out for myself. And those are just the things that you kind of learn. And hopefully you grab a mentor, or you even reach out to anybody at Tufts, either myself, anybody on this platform, whoever, to really kind of give you a breakdown of certain practices that, you know, we do every day now because we had to learn to do them. But if we give them to you on the front end, you won't have to necessarily go through all of the stress and the turmoil that we did. So, you know, it's a real thing. You know, your mental health is extremely important. And I'm telling you now, we've had a couple of instances, but we've had an instance here at Tufts. I've heard about instances at other schools where, you know, you really do have to make sure that you're prioritizing your mental health, because it can be very depressing if you allow it to be. So that's another little piece of advice that if any of you all want to talk to me about, of course, we can go a little bit deeper into that. Boom. Okay, so dental school year by year. So another thing that we did on my platform, Future DDS, is for 2 years, and this year is about to come up, so we have another one coming out. We actually interviewed a dental student at every single dental school in the U.S. So if you want to go to LECOM, if you want to go to UConn, if you want to go to UCLA, if you want to go to Texas A&M, if you want to go to Detroit Mercy, wherever you want to go, if you go to our YouTube page, Future DDS, you will be able to find the school of your choice and watch an actual interview from a student who goes to that school. Like I said, we did that for 2 years in a row. We're working on the third season right now. It's a great resource to kind of help you narrow down your decisions and just kind of get a perspective as if you kind of knew somebody at that dental school and you were asking them real questions. So go check that out. Hope you all enjoy that. But here's kind of like my breakdown of the 4 years of dental school. So year one, intro and review. A lot of you all have taken classes, science classes, in undergrad or in your master's program. And so all the stuff that you see your first year, you've kind of seen before. So anatomy, microbiome, biochemistry, all those type classes that you took and you had to get good grades in order to get to dental school anyway, right? So D1 was an intro and a review. We're not doing that much stuff with our hands yet. Granted, we're doing some little preps, but like I said, it's very, very basic level stuff. D2 year was a lot tougher. And I say that because they literally upped the amount of credits that we took. So I think we were taking like 30 credits per semester. But the thing was, it's all new information. Now we're taking fixed pros. We're taking a complete denture course. We're taking an operative course. We're taking occlusion course. All these different things that I've never seen before. And it was just a lot at one time on top of doing lab projects. So when I say complete dentures, right, we would have a lab portion as well as a class portion. So we would go to class for 3 hours, boom. And then we'd have projects to do. And with these projects, I'm really making dentures. I've never made dentures before. So that's a whole nother stress. And keep in mind, you have to do this outside of class time. So we would be in class from, I'll say from like 9 to 5, and then have to stay in lab until 5:30 until 9, getting these projects done. And so, you know, when you might have asked, you know, Tyler, why do you wake up at 5 a.m. now? Because 5 a.m. to 8, that's the time when I was able to do my meditations, my workouts, and have my me time, because the rest of the day was just gone. So keep that in mind. I know a lot of schools a lot of schools are kind of trying to change this and make it a more so like integrated approach where everything is spread out evenly over the 4 years. I think Tufts is moving towards that a little bit as well, or not over the 2 years, but over the D1 and D2 year. I think that will definitely lessen the load of everything. So reach out to your schools and kind of see how they do things. But that's how Tufts did it when I was here, or when I was in D2. D3, I put why I came here clinic. Now, at the end of the D2 year, I'm tired. Everybody's tired. We're all exhausted. And keep in mind, like, we haven't even seen a patient. And so it's kind of, I don't say it's discouraging, but after being in straight classes for 2 years, like I said, you're just tired. And you're like, what am I paying $100,000 a year for? Like, I am cold. I could go back to Georgia. Like, what's going on? But then, boom, you walk into clinic and you have your first patient and you start having these interactions that you had just watched classes on the year before about asking your patient their health history, asking your patient their nutritional needs, all these different things. and you get a burst of new energy when you get into clinic. And I'm not saying that it's easier, because it's not, but it's just different and it's refreshing and it's rewarding. Me talking to my patients and doing whatever, me completing a treatment plan with my patient feels 3 times better than me ever getting an A on the test. And you all feel the same way, I promise you. I'm D4, so that's where I'm at now. Now, of course, with COVID, things have been a little bit skewed, but D4 is a whole new book, because now I'm looking at job opportunities. People are applying to residencies, and I'm looking into, I have to get insurance, and I'm like, okay, hold on, now I'm actually a real adult. Am I going to go buy a house? Am I going to go buy a car? Am I going to go do this? So it's just a lot going on top of you still trying to finish your requirements and you being expected to be a leader now in clinic because you've been there for a year. So, you know, we're walking around clinic, D3s are running up to us. Hey, Tyler, what should I do with this border molding, whatever it may be? They look at me like I'm supposed to know, because I am. And so it's just a lot going on. It's a lot going on. You're stepping into a new position. You're stepping into a new position whilst leaving a new position also, because I'm about to leave in 2 months and become a real doctor. But it's exciting. It's very exciting. It's weird, because I don't even feel like it's been 4 years, and you all won't either. It goes by so fast. It's literally like a blink. And, you know, me and my group of friends, we sit back sometimes and we're like, wow, we're really done. Like, this is crazy. And, you know, we start thinking about little things like, wow, is this the last time we're all going to be together? Like, and of course not, but these little things start going through your head like, wow, like we spent the last 4 years together, 4 years in this building. And now we're about to start another new chapter. And this is a new chapter that a lot of our friends have already started, because they might have not gone to professional school or whatever it may be. So we're really walking into adulthood. And it's exciting. It's very exciting. Boom. So, tips for success in dental school. Be efficient with your time. Now, like I said, you're going to have to learn how to do this. If you don't learn how to do this, you will fall behind. And of course, you need you time. You need you time, but not too much you time. So what does that mean? So, you know, there are some people who would go home and be super tired, which is understandable, and binge Netflix from the time they finish class until night, and then they pass out and they wake up and they might go to class and do the same thing over and over again. But then what happens when, you know, you have a test and you haven't reviewed that material? Now you're stressed out. Now you're put under extra pressure, and now you're not performing to your highest ability. Not good. And keep in mind, that's just the aspect of clinic. You don't want to be so tired that when you actually go into school, you don't want to talk to people. You're, oh, hey. You lose that joyous spirit. No. What you want to do is be super efficient, so that when you sit down and you do study, you're not on YouTube. You're not listening to, I mean, some people listen to music, that's fine. But you're not on Instagram. You're not doing things. You say, hey, you know what? I'm out of class. I'm going to spend 2 hours studying. And then from 7:30 until 10, that's me time. If you just stay efficient and stay like to a strict schedule, you will be fine. And don't expect yourself to have that schedule like locked down when you first go into school. It's very, very it's very relative to each person. What somebody does might not work for you. You know, you might not be somebody who wakes up at 5 a.m., but you're somebody who stays up a little later. And you like to study at night, whatever it may be, but just, you have to find your own groove, find out, you know, what classes you need to study a little bit more for, which classes you don't need to study as much for. And you'll find your groove for sure. Just make a conscious effort to find that groove, if that makes sense. Okay. So number two, be extra. Being extra in dental school. And what I mean by this, I don't mean be annoying, but what I do mean is, go and talk to faculty. Go talk to these doctors who have been doing dentistry for 40 years. I promise you, they'll sit there and talk to you. You know, I think there's so much forgotten resources because, you know, people don't want to make that extra effort to just go and have a conversation with somebody. You know, you will be surprised how much you going to that one club meeting will get you, or you signing up for that one implant course that's at 8 p.m. Granted, you might be super tired, but say you go, you make connections with whoever's giving the course, and they say, you know what, Adam, I like you, Adam. I'm going to give you this course for free when you graduate. Just hit me up. Boom. That's a connection. That's a free implant course that costs $20,000 that now you don't have to pay because you decided to be extra and go to that course at 8 p.m. at night when you were tired. Do that. Keep doing that. Take advantage of every opportunity, because another thing that a lot of people don't tell you, everybody loves a student. When you're not a student anymore and you just like a normal person running around, granted, you'll be a doctor, which is awesome. But when you're a real adult, you got to pay for everything. And a lot of these courses cost a lot of money, a lot of money. So while you're still a student, take advantage of everything. And I'm talking about even when you're graduating. So right now, you know, granted, we got some loops. I don't really like the loops. They're okay. They're a little heavy. Now I kind of have big ears, so they kind of sit a little weird. So now I'm going to these different loop companies. Hey, I'm a student. Do you have a student discount? Hey, disability insurance. I'm a student. Can I get a student rate? Hey, malpractice insurance. I'm about to graduate, but I'm still a student. Can I get a student rate? And you will always get a student rate. Always. So keep that in mind. Three, use your student doctor title as leverage. And that kind of goes back to what I was saying earlier. Whereas you being a student, everybody loves a student, but you being a student doctor, you also, people look at you a certain type of way, right? And so what do I mean by that? You have to be conscious of what you do and how you present yourself to the world, because now you're going to be a future doctor. So people are looking at you realistically like you're a doctor. I'm not going to lie to you. My patients call me Dr. Brown. They say, Dr. Brown, this. And they trust you as if you are already a doctor. So remember to always be professional, always be, think of this as your craft. And that sounds cheesy, but I think that when people take ownership of it like that, you're able to really invest into it a lot more. So yeah, that's what the student doctor title. Boom, remember your family and friends. You will be surprised how long you will go sometimes without talking to any of your friends. And I'm talking about real conversations. I'm not talking about the occasional DM. You know, it got to a point, like one of my best friends back home, he was like, bro, I haven't heard from you in like 2 months. And I'm like, you know, bro, I'm talking to him on Instagram. We're laughing. We have group chats. But he's like, nah, bro, like, I just want to, you know, talk to you as a homie. Like, what's going on? And you start to forget that these are the people who supported you to even get to this point. And granted, I know everybody is super busy and you will be super busy, but you picking up the phone, calling somebody, talking to them for 20 minutes, you know, you will be surprised how far that goes and how much that means to the people who helped you get to where you are right now. And unfortunately, what you'll also see is that a lot of people might not even reach out to you. A lot of your friends might not reach out to you. And you know why? They'll say, bro, I thought you were busy, bro. Like, I know you got stuff going on. You know, I didn't want to step in. I know you're studying, but it's like, no, like you reaching out to them. Granted, it's another job, but it's another responsibility. You know, that means three times more because they do know you're busy and they know you want to keep that commitment going. And granted, this might sound crazy to y'all, but it was so bad with me that I actually kind of implemented this thing at least every week. I'm having two conversations with my friends on the phone, literally like, hey, how you doing? Blase blue, blase blase. Just want to check in with you, bro. And that goes so much longer because you have to also check in on your friends. You know, like, granted, they might not be stressed because of dental school, but it's a crazy world out here. You all see how much is going on. So never stop being a friend. Never stop being a son, a daughter, a sister, a brother, a grandson, a granddaughter. Just remember the people who got you there. And number five, pay extra attention in prost. Prost is dentistry, you know, and prost is very, very meticulous subject that you all will take. And when I say prost, I'm meaning everything. Like, we're talking removable dentures. We're talking about crown and bridge. We're talking about all of that. We're talking about a lot to do with occlusion. Like, all these different things fall into a prost. And it's super important that you pay attention to that class. It was one of the more difficult classes because you're dealing with like a lot of measurements and all the angulation and things of that nature. And I remember I was just happy to get through it. I was like, wow, this is stressful. You know what? I'm going to worry about this when I'm in clinic. But what I ended up doing was spending a lot more time going back and having to rewatch all my pros lectures when I was in clinic, because when I was in the actual class, I didn't do my due diligence and really, you know, get my reps in and read each PowerPoint two or three times. I was more so like, yo, this is so stressful. I don't know what's going on. And it was almost kind of intimidating to me. But if I could go back in time, I would have really, really, really spent more time looking at pros, and that's, you know, everything, dentures, crown and bridge, all that. So boom. And the best piece of advice that I've actually gotten, it was from one of my mentors. He said, Tyler, you have to be accepting of who you are, not who you want to become. And what does that mean? Basically, I think that we all have an image of ourselves, right? And we want to be that perfect image of our future self even. You know, I forever had a chip on my shoulder as far as like, you know, I'm going to be a doctor, so I need to do things this way, this way, this way, this way. And when things didn't necessarily go the way I had planned, I would find myself super, super, super disappointed, super hurt, just like really disappointed in myself. And that trickles into a whole bunch of other, you know, emotions that you can get. And so it got to a point where I was like, yo, I am not that perfect person that I aspire to be. Honestly, I might never become that person, to be quite frank, you know, like, but at the end of the day, who I am now, I can't be mad at the mistakes I'm making, because those mistakes are going to get me to the person that I want to be in the future, if that makes sense. And so, you know, don't put too much pressure on yourself, but really do be realistic about your strengths and your weaknesses, and just continue to build, continue to self-reflect. That's one of the things that me and a bunch of my friends do. Every week we have self-reflection. Like, what did I do good this week? What were my goals for this week? Did I hit these goals? What were my habits this week? And really just track yourself and track your progress. And you will definitely, definitely, you know, get to become the person that you want to become. So yeah, boom. Contact information on IG, at Dr. T Brown is my personal IG. For Instagram, this is actually wrong for the Future DDS one. It's at underscore Future DDS. Go check us out on Instagram. Like I said, on YouTube, just type in Future DDS and you'll see the orange smile. That's me and my roommate. We built that platform just for you all. So definitely go check it out. And also my email, tybrown0629@gmail.com. You all can reach out on any platform, on email, IG at any time. I am getting better at responding to all the text messages in a timely manner, or emails, DMs, whatever it may be, but I definitely, definitely will get back to you. It might be 2 or 3 days, 4 days. But you know, that's why I'm here. You know, I mean, my roommate as well, Future DDS, a lot of people on Instagram are here to help you all, because we didn't necessarily have this. Like, we didn't have such a great platform as Dental Shadowing to kind of lean on and hear different perspectives. We didn't have any of these resources, and we were all where you are right now. And so we want to help as many people as possible get to be able to achieve their dreams. So yeah, we're here to help, and whatever you all need, just reach out to me and I'll definitely answer any of y'all's questions. All right. And yeah.
Awesome. So we have some questions for you. The first question was in regards to a personal statement. What would you say would be like the biggest do in a personal statement and the biggest don't in a personal statement?
Biggest do, be yourself and tell a unique story. Unique. And that can mean a lot of different things. I don't know what your unique looks like because it's your story. Don't be boring. Like, I think that a lot of people follow that, like, my parents were a dentist and I grew up in the dental practice and I really want to become a dentist. That's boring. And, you know, we have friends on admissions councils who are reading these essays and they're like, everybody's saying the same thing. Everybody. Be unique and say something or tell a unique story. And you know what is a unique story. You know, like, people are like, I don't know if this is unique enough. You know if you have a unique story. And if not, you know, if you don't have a unique story, that's also okay. But try to be more introspective with your essay. Like, it doesn't have to be the the stereotypical, you know, I grew up here, I shadowed here, I did this. Like, don't write anything in your personal statement that they can get from your actual application. Don't talk about your GPA. Granted, you could talk about one of the experiences that you put in your application, but don't make your personal statement just a reiteration of your actual application. It doesn't make sense. Your personal statement should be personal and they should feel like they're speaking to you. And like the biggest don't be boring.
And then another question was a little bit about your scholarship that you mentioned. What was the scholarship a reflection of?
So the scholarship was a reflection of my DAT score. I did decent on the DAT. I think I got like a 23, but that was back in the day. So I took the DAT like 6 years ago, I want to say. So 23 was cool back then. I think that things are getting a little bit more competitive, but that's why I'm kind of trying to tell people, like, if you're somebody who's able to get like a 25 or a 26, you know, scholarships are available. I know two students actually who are in my master's program. They got 27s on the DAT and their entire dental school was paid for. Their entire dental school. Granted, is that a rare case? Of course, very rare. Very rare, but it is possible. And also, I don't know how many people are open to this. I definitely was not open to it when I first came to dental school, but even looking into the military, I have a homegirl. She's super cool, you know, super girly, realistically, like super girly. She's doing the Navy scholarship and everything paid for, rent paid for, dental school paid for. She also gets like a stipend every single month to live. So she's getting like $2,000 a month just to live. And her obligation to the Navy is she has to go work for 4 years for the Navy and still make a salary. You know what I'm saying? So it's kind of like there are a lot of benefits to it. And I remember when I first was starting and doing all my application and stuff, I was like, I'll never do the military. That's ridiculous. I would never do that. But now that I'm on the end of everything and I'm looking at, you know, that $500,000, and I'm thinking about all the interest that's going to accrue on that $500,000, you know, the military doesn't seem like that bad of an idea.
And then another question referring to cost. You talked a lot about how dental school isn't cheap. Mm-hmm. What would you say to those who are scared to pursue dentistry because of that?
Okay, so one, do your research. You know, I think that there's a lot of information out there to kind of help you decide on what it is that you know, is the $500,000 worth it to you? I'll tell people now, like, if you specialize, okay, let's talk averages, right? And this is just from what I've been hearing. If you are a general dentist, on average, I've heard you'll make around like 160. And that's for you working for somebody. If you are an owner of your own practice, I've heard that number go from like 350 to 400 if you own your own practice. If you specialize, for instance, oral surgery is an automatic 400,000. Orthodontics is pretty much automatic 300,000. Peds, if you love kids, automatic 250,000. But I think that even if you decide to, you know, you want to be a general dentist, you want to make $160,000, you will still be able to pay back those loans. You know, I think there are so many tools out there today that can kind of show you, you know, how you'll be able to do it. Granted, you might be paying that loan off for a while, but there's certain repayment options like Payee, which basically will take 10% of your income. That's what will go towards your loans. And then after like 20 years or something, your loans are expunged, so they're just gone. But then again, you'd still have to pay a tax bomb. So you're still gonna end up paying the $500,000. But, you know, I think there's a lot of stuff to think about. If you are somebody who plans on getting married, whoever your spouse is, you know, maybe they'll be able to help you out. And I mean, realistically, if you're in a position where you are able to go and live with your parents for like 2 years and save as much money as possible, you can easily make that $500,000 loan go down to 250. And 250 is very, very, very manageable. But yeah, it's all about what you want to do. Just be honest with yourself and say, you know, dentistry at this point isn't about the money. Now, you'll make a decent living, But unless you're somebody who wants to specialize or who wants to own multiple practices, you know, you shouldn't be getting, dentistry is not going to make you rich. You know, I think that there used to be this image of a dentist like driving a Lambo and working 2 days a week. It's not necessarily that anymore, especially with insurances, insurances kind of realistically controlling the pricing and of everything. It's just getting more, it's getting less and less about being rich and more so your impact on people's lives. So if you want to have huge, massive impact, dentistry is for you. If you want to become rich, it's, you know, and this is just from my, you know, my understanding. Granted, I'm not in the real world yet, so I really don't know, but that's just from what I've gathered from a bunch of different people.
And then another question is, how has dental school changed you as a person?
Dental school has made me a lot more thoughtful as a person. I pay more attention to details in all aspects of my life. Also with regards to, like I said earlier, my relationships. You know, I think that in order to be a great dentist, you have to become very emotionally intelligent. And I think I was not that coming into dental school. I think that I was more so all about, you know, the grind. I love the grind. I love reaching these goals. I love doing XXX. But dentistry, you know, dentistry makes you kind of step back and look at the whole picture. You know, before I ever drill a tooth, I'm talking to my patient and I'm trying to see how they feel. How do you feel during this pandemic? How do you feel about dentistry? Because a lot of people are coming into the office scared, like nervous. That's the initial emotion that they have. And so now, you know, with emotional intelligence, you know, there's certain things that you learn that like, okay, this is what you have to do. Oh, if this person, if their body language is a certain way, you should approach a situation like this or different things like that. And dental school has also just made me more thankful, you know, and grateful of everything that I have. You know, I think that with dental school every day, you know, it's very easy to complain, right? You might be super tired, you know, you might be super, oh, that professor did XXX, But I'm like, yo, at the end of the day, you're complaining about the opportunity to become a doctor. Like, we think this is hard work and it is difficult, but what I constantly tell myself, there is somebody who has three kids and is working a way, way tougher job than I am trying to make ends meet for their family. That's hard. You know, me being able to come and talk to my friends and talk to my patients, laugh, have a great time, live in a nice apartment building in Boston. It's rough, but it could be a lot worse. And so dental school has also helped me become very, very grateful for everything that I have, for sure.
And then what has been your biggest mental health outlet throughout your dental journey?
Peace. I think that, you know, it's great being with my friends. I say my friends and peace, right? All my real good friends who are around me are in dental school, you know? So it's like, we all are kind of going through the same troubles, trials and tribulations. We all are able to, you know, when we do feel like complaining, even though we shouldn't be, we can complain to each other and laugh about certain things and really just relate. But there's some times when I do just turn my mind off. And like I said, like at the end of the night, like I work really hard to make sure that those last like two and a half hours are just me time. And like, sometimes I want to just turn my mind off and not think about everything that's going on right now. Not think about what I have due for a clinic. Not think about, oh, my patient, she's calling me. She's in pain. Oh, this sucks that I can't like see her right now. Oh man, these loans amount. It's just a lot going on at once. So me being able to really like get that peace of mind, wake up in the morning, be by myself, go to the gym, be by myself, at night, turn on a movie, be by myself, that really has helped me keep my peace of mind, and me really kind of establishing boundaries as well. And that's more so boundaries for myself. Like I try to stay off of Instagram after 8 p.m. I try to stop doing certain things after 8 p.m. I really just try to calm down and really learn about the calm down so that I can get a certain quality of sleep. Because that's another thing. You know, I don't know if this happened to everybody, but during throughout dental school, especially during that second year, there was a lot of anxiety built up, you know, because you're always being tested. You're always being evaluated. You're always learning something new. You're always feeling unsure. So it got to a point where I wasn't getting a good night's sleep because I was so anxious. And granted, you're not outwardly talking about this because, I mean, this sucks, but a lot of people are going through the same thing. And so you're just kind of like, okay, what do I look complaining about something that everybody's going through? And so, you know, what me and my friends have talked about, what I've just done my research on, just really learning on how to like calm down and really taking that time to myself. Because within dentistry, all day you're giving yourself away. You're talking to, it's all about your patients. Your patients are everything. And so if I'm giving all of myself to everybody else all day, I really need some time in within my day for myself and just to make sure that Tyler's okay. Because if Tyler's okay, I can be a better clinician to my patients. I can be a better son. I can listen to when my sister calls me and she's upset. I can listen to when my dad calls me and he needs something from me. But you have to take that time out to really make sure that you're good. And that's what I've just made sure that I do.
And then someone was wondering a little bit about dental school. What kind of procedures do you guys actually get to or do in dental school?
So we do everything. So we do scaling and root planning. And so basically that's when somebody has like, you all know what plaque is. Plaque is like, think of plaque as squishy and think of calculus as hard. So when somebody has a super hard piece of calculus on their tooth and they say it's sub G, so it's below the gingiva, we go in there, numb the patient up, and we're scraping all that calculus off. Boom. We have patients coming in getting complete dentures. So I might have a patient, I see the patient has 12 teeth that are rotten out. All her other teeth are gone, or whatever their teeth are, they're all gone. She has 12 teeth in her mouth. Okay, I'm gonna have to go extract all of these teeth and then give you complete dentures. Boom. We do crowns. Crowns is huge. So basically, you have a tooth. I go and I prep the tooth, make sure that it's a great prep, take the impression, send the impression out, a lab sends back a crown, boom, grab the crown, put that back on. We do, of course, treatment planning and diagnosing, right? So patient comes in, hey, Tyler, my tooth hurts. Okay, patient A, what tooth hurts? When did this start to happen? What, you know, does cold stimulate this pain? What's going on? Let me go look at your x-rays. Then we take the x-rays. I look at all the x-rays. Okay. Let me check out your gums. Okay. You have a, you know, deeper probing depth here. Also on the radiograph, I see that you have a periapical radiolucency. That's not good. That means something's going on. Let me diagnose this, blah, blah, blah. We do everything. We do everything in dental school. I haven't been able to actually place an implant, but at any time you can actually go upstairs and watch the periodontist place implants. And then of course, after they place the implants, they come back down to UG and we do the actual restoration being the crown. So you're involved in the process, but you might not necessarily like, well, I haven't placed implants, but pretty much everything else we do.
And then our last question for you, kind of connected to that, what is your favorite procedure to perform?
So in dentistry, we are in the business of saving teeth, right? So you always want to keep a tooth if possible. You want to be as conservative when you're making a prep as you can possibly be. But with that being said, I love extractions. Like, I don't know what it is. It's almost just like a weird relief. It's just like, and there's so much technique that goes into it. And it's very simple, but it's not easy, especially when you get into the realm of doing surgical extractions. And I don't know what it is. I just love it. I love doing extractions, and I probably shouldn't, but I love doing them.
Awesome. Well, that is going to conclude our session. Thank you so much, Tyler, for coming and talking to us today. We really appreciate it.
Of course, I appreciate you all having me on.